Welcome back, everybody. I was gonna say all the creepy business is done. We can move on to other things, but with Strash around, it's never
getting
complete.
More creepy.
The creepy business.
I love it. I love it. It's so good.
The thing I wanted to mention before too is that this is happening. We just described demons in a bath and making arcane packs and da 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 da, and like three rooms over, like Cantor's like asleep on a couch, like.
Yeah. Like there's a little snore. He's got a half empty bottle of something in one hand.
Yeah.
Like, scratches the new tattoo.
First, he's like talking to Anya about like how we're going to get in with Kiel and what his like guards' hours are and things like that. Yeah.
Oh my God. Yeah, it made me realize that in the parallel here, I guess that makes Oscar, you're Egon and I'm Peter. Oh God.
Yes, this has been my secret plan to just get us to play Ghostbusters.
Yeah. Oh, that's so funny. It's totally true. Gosh, I like it because you're building the unlicensed nuclear accelerators. That's yep.
I am. Just don't look into the trap.
Yeah, I'm pretty. Oscar, I looked into the trap.
You said making packs with demons was bad.
I can't wait until Satara asks one of us if we're a god.
If she asks Cantor, we already know the answer. Yeah.
There is no Oscar, only Zool.
He has his new tattoo that says, I am a god, across his forehead.
Yeah, totally. Hey, I'm unstable. It's fine.
Oh, yeah, we didn't ask you, Adam. What did you get? What's your tattoo?
I think it's very, like one of those tattoos where if you just looked at it, it would look like a random assortment of like letters and numbers. Like it's totally like CH in like blood red with like the year and the month and the day, like, and then
it's
probably
all stylized, like,
yeah.
Together and stuff.
Yeah. And then some kind of symbology about like where we came from. Like it's probably like a row of towers or something, you know? Yeah, definitely.
And you should also make a clock for your character for demon blood exposure.
I'm sorry, I heard you say getting superpowers. I will write that down right now. Thank you.
Yeah, that's what I said.
Yeah, that's what I heard.
Well, those could be one and the same.
Four parts.
Yeah.
And fill one in.
Okay.
So
I noticed over the break, I was looking at my other character sheet, the dating clock was actually only four segments, but
that's okay. Well, if you want to roll the other ones into the next clock, that's fine.
Okay, cool. That's what I was gonna.
Yeah,
you did spend the segments and it is two of.
Okay, cool. All right, totally. So yeah, demon blood exposure, one of four. I don't know, I kind of like, I want more. I want to like, I'm going to see what happens when I get to four, because I assume superpowers.
I think you're right.
Almost certainly
I would
not,
say the first experience was euphoric, and then who knows what happens from there.
Yeah.
No wonder people like it. Where are your cats? Where are your new cats?
This one's probably like a big garish back piece. Like just like big, like, yes. Yeah.
So would we see it? I mean, just kind of like walk around the manor with the shirt off?
Yeah, totally.
Yeah.
Definitely. Yeah.
So it's not like the thug tattoo like right here.
I already had that. That's that was there already.
Okay.
So this is, yeah.
All right, cool.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, you had that like hand under your rib cage, the Brogan did, you know, like
the
sea hand. So like when RC sees it, as you like walk by, she like looks to Oscar and just like, can't believe he's using her own product. Like, what an idiot.
I've also come up with like a cool like blood letters like gang sign that I like flash you whenever you look at me now. I'm just like, what's up?
Lala.
Trying to get you to do it.
That's perfect because like she totally like says like, oh, Kander's an idiot, but like Austria can super read. She's hella jealous. Like, damn, he got one first.
actually, Oscar doesn't really notice because so the thing is that, like, to Oscar, this is perfectly normal. He was raised by, like, ghosts and demons. So, you know, you buy apples in the morning, you make there you go.
I'm trying to, like make a BL in my hands. I'm trying to figure out.
So I think you're just like, man, I can't believe Cantor got a tattoo, you know, with our product. And Oscar's just like, Do you want one?
Are you like, no?
I have the good stuff down in the basement. You know, before we cut it for like the clientele.
Yeah.
Are you sure?
We got bored to doing stuff. Busy. Later. I don't know.
I'm waiting for that moment when Oscar's like, watch this. And like Cantor like falls asleep and just like collapses on the floor. But
yeah.
Pretty cool, huh?
It's coming one of these days.
Three more ticks.
That's right. That's right.
All right.
All right.
Okay, so downtime's over, and I think there's a few things we could do, but meeting with Basho seemed to be at the top of that list.
Yeah, and I think it's probably the one that we can leverage into a proper job the easiest.
Yeah, I think this is in our ongoing process of tutorializing Blades in the Dark as we also just play it straight. There is a thing you can do, which is, you know, normally going on a score is the thing that your crew playbook is about, and then when you do it, you get money and rep and stuff. And that's what you plan. You like plan a score. But there's no rule, that's not an actual rule. Like, you can actually plan any type of operation, go and do it, and then like try to get paid out of that operation as part of the thing. Mm-hmm. So this is that version of that, where we're saying like, okay, we're gonna plan, we're gonna basically make a social plan, unless you guys wanna meet Basho by assaulting or infiltrating his base or something. We're making a social plan. We have the opportunity. We're going to roll engagement to see who starts out with the upper hand. And then we're going to just sort of turn that situation into a score for our crew, being cool and savvy.
Yep.
Do you guys want to pop in stealthy like? Because I've been practicing with the ghost field.
Well, no, there's
no absolutely normal. Okay.
We've been invited.
Yes, you've been invited.
No. What's the point in wasting the invitation? But as long as you're talking about just popping into someone's home with a ghost feel, I happen to know when Keel's guards are at their stations, and we have their kid's carriage driver in our pocket now. Just saying, for the future. This is
the next thing we'll have to do is figure out what exactly we want from him.
Yeah, everything. To make him suffer. To take all his money and then piss it in front of his face. we want to, he's rich. We want to take everything he's got.
We're not thieves. We're hawkers. What we need from him is leverage, and we need to figure out how we're going to turn him.
Sure.
I mean, screaming in his bedroom at night when we infiltrate the place is totally option, but, you know.
I like that Arcee's answer is like, sure.
Yeah, whatever you say.
Okay. We'll work on it for next time.
I'm gonna do whatever I want, but nice, good talk, Oscar, good talk.
Yep. Well, yeah, so she plants the seeds that could be done, but for now let's take up.
Yeah, it sounds like Oscar is has announced a potential new power to the crew here, so that you've got that on your radar. And of course, as usual, you don't ask any questions about how or why that is a thing.
You don't need to know that shit.
No. So Arcee, and Cantor too, actually. Let's think about this. So Cantor's background is legit underworld. So you actually know Basho, and he would know you by face if you mattered ever before now. He would sort of recognize you or something.
Yeah.
But also, Arcee has a really close relationship with Cyclops, who's currently like the real touch point for the gang in the underworld. The reason I'm asking is when we make this engagement role, like, socially, which of you, and it also could be Oscar. I didn't include Oscar because...
No, Oscar is actually going to put on his costume because when we do illicit things, I no longer want it to be associated with my real persona.
Gotcha, cool.
I'll let them talk for the most part.
So which of the two of you, who would like to be sort of the point person for the engagement with Basho here?
I think that you've asked a classic R.C. Cantor question, which they're both going to say yes.
Yep,
totally. Of course.
I mean, all it's funny because we're both pretty bad at being social. Like, we both have one consort, right?
And
like,
so this is just to be clear mechanically, this is just the engagement part. Like, when you go to meet him, does he have a big advantage? Do you have a big advantage? Are you on even footing? And that's all determined by how vulnerable socially he is. And I'm going to judge that by which one of you is the person.
Right.
And
so
this, either of you know, you haven't done any, you know,
this,
you haven't looked into Basho. You don't know which one of you he might be more better disposed towards. I'm asking you in the dark here who to pick.
So RC will posit, Sean, as me, I'm fine either way. I'm telling you, RC will posit that she is the one who sent the message to the Red Sashes that we are their enemy and we are going to destroy them. And we know that Basho hates Red Sashes. We've known that since we've gotten here. And that he is going to know that I sent them packing, regardless of the fact that you all actually think they'd be killing. And I sent the message to Malara Clove. So that's what, you know, much more adamantly and fiercely than I will present it, Arcee will say, yeah, he's going to respect my name. He's going to know my name.
Yeah, I mean that's how this works, right? Like you roll up and talk big, and then I start
shooting people,
and Oscar does something I'm not totally clear about, but seems to work out most of the time.
I'm the mascot.
Yeah, you're the good luck charm is the thing, and keep the goblins or whatever away from us. So.
Cool.
Yeah. Did you actually agree? It went by so fast. My head is.
I mean, I think it's funny because I think we're all simultaneously like, it just looks like we're agreeing, but I'm like, they're both gonna fuck this up, and they're both like, he's gonna fuck this up. Like, we're all just like, no, this is the plan, this is what we're gonna do, but we're all secretly thinking, I better go when they screw up so I can.
Right, like, I better be prepared for that other one to fuck it up.
Yeah.
I think that RC is better put in front. But if we're going to make any money, Cantor's going to see the opportunity. Yeah. And I think that he can't see the opportunity if he's too busy primping his coat. So,
I can do both at once. All right.
What I'm hearing is RC is going to answer the invitation and let Basho knows that you're coming. You don't just sort of show up at his headquarters.
Yeah.
And you introduce yourself by confirming that you're the person who sent the bodies to the Red Sashes. That's sort of your calling card.
Yeah.
Okay. Technically, I commanded an undead to
kill. Let's not get technical.
Exactly.
We the blood letters. We just roll up.
Details.
It was my message that he brought back. That's going to be the, Arcee's message. No, I think we're all obviously like, yeah, no, that was me. No, I hit him in the corpse, though, but I.
Yeah. Oh, man. I can see the day when the tables turn here in the gang and Oscar is ascendant, and it's going to be a thing. It's going to be a thing.
I have a demon clock with Zatara that's slowly ticking towards that day. I'm just saying.
I know. Oh boy.
It's all good. Let's just move right
now. No, I don't think it's going to change because Oscar, once he reaches his power, is going to be like, awesome. Cantor and Arcee can be my little puppets and do whatever. They can be in the front and do my bidding.
The thing is, though, is that Arcee and Cantor won't even notice that anything has changed. Like, it'll just be the same because Oscar does stuff and no one notices, and he'll continue to do stuff no one will notice, and it'll be fine. We'll just
until one time when he goes, exactly, watch this track, and then the bar will Arcee and Cantor fall down.
It'll be fine.
That is probably true, actually. Yeah, they still won't get it. You're like literally summoning demons in front of them, and they're like, what do you even do here?
What do you do? What's your thing? Like, you don't even have any guns or anything. What?
I don't like guns.
Yeah.
All right, John Wilson Dice, I gotta grab tea. I'll be right back. One sec. All right.
I'm gonna let you roll, Sean. So go.
Yep. So we're the plan here then is that RC is like taking charge, because that's the only thing that RC's good at, is just like being fronting. Bossy. Yeah.
Fronting.
Totally, full on fronting. And then
she's making the introduction. So the for a social plan, the detail is your social connection with that person.
Yeah.
So I take the detail that you provide and I judge how vulnerable the target is at the opening.
Can we talk real quick about Bajo's gang versus ours and like what we're looking at in terms of, like, are we the same size now or?
You are the same size now.
So we're going to deal with Bajo as equals now instead of, okay.
You are equals in terms of scale. You're not equals in terms of reputation.
Sure.
The Lamplacks are very well known.
Yeah, reputation is a product of action, though. So what matters is that we have the, in Cantor's mind, certainly, we have the size to be able to say, okay, you got a gang this big? Well, so do we. So now we're going to make our rep.
If you went to war with the Lamplacks and only fought the Lamplacks, you're the same size as them. If they don't have any friends, which they totally do, but if they didn't.
They've got enemies, too, so.
They do. They have.
And they're at war with the Red Sashes and the Crows at the same time.
Yeah. Exactly. I don't think they're at war with the Crows, are they? They're still trying to broker deal.
We could just dress up like his gang and then go pick fights with the Crows until they're at war with the Crows. Problem solved.
Hey, cool. I need a totally sweet name for my crazy red tattered persona.
Oh yeah, maybe chat can help with that.
Yes, chat.
Yeah.
The first thing I thought of was the Red Hand, because it's just very simple, but there's probably a better name.
You know, I was watching Adam play Darkest Dungeon, which is a pretty sweet game, and I was thinking of the guys in the plague masks, like when you were describing. It's not the same, but I thought Plague Bearer. I don't know, like that's just what I envisioned when you described the mask.
Yeah, it's. I had a plague mask last game, but I think this one's like gold with like a leviathan eye and yeah, I've got the like red tatters and probably like.
I think. I mean, I feel like when we're talking about like this is a TV show or whatever, like if you go with the red hand thing, we've got like the whole like that Nick Cave song, the red right hand. Like you got a theme song already with that All one. Right. Like
yeah, no, red hand sounds good to me.
That's true. Yeah.
Scarlet Harlot.
Like a lot of these are like wrestler names.
The Rouge Rogue.
The Scarlet Harlot. And in this corner.
Weigh in at 100.
You be the Red Hand. I'll be the Scarlet Harlot. It'll be sweet.
All right. So the persona hasn't been out enough to get a nickname yet, but it will soon.
Yeah.
Yeah, okay, so you contact Bajo using the ciphers, the messengers of the city that are notoriously scrupulous and reliable and secret, because otherwise they would quickly be murdered and disappear. and you arrange a meeting, and he does not want to meet at the headquarters. The Lamplacks have this old... like the where they used to operate from when they were the Lamplighter Guild for the city, before they got put out of business by electric lights. They had this big warehouse, just like fortified sort of castle base in Crowsfoot. But he doesn't want to meet there. He wants to meet somewhere else. That I had the page open and now I think it's a bar that they run. Which is also in Crowsfoot, as I recall. Here we go. Right, it's called the Leaky Bucket.
That is a dumbass name for a place. Leaky Bucket.
I love it.
So, you guys know it's in their turf. It's like they own it, essentially.
Can there be just like a really shitty roof on this place and just all like leaks that come in and like various buckets are just sort of like perpetually like be getting filled up and emptied out? Because I don't think we described the weather of basketball all the time. But I imagine, you know, like the sun is never up. It's always sort of dark. It's gloomy. I imagine that rain is a big part of it as well.
It is, yeah. And it's yeah, way
like,
far north.
Sounds like Vancouver.
Yeah. It's further north than that even. It's like an icy rain is pretty common, at least for about half the year. And then it's overcast and drizzly the rest of the time. So yeah, there's a nice icy rain going, and I was thinking it was kind of nicer, but maybe like the name was ironic. But Sean, what if it was always that, and when they fixed it up, they like left one of the holes behind?
Yeah.
So there's like this like old bucket that they left, and they didn't fix the hole in the roof. It's like,
right. Because they had to keep it for the namesake,
like,
because that's what it used to be.
Yeah.
So
total shithole.
The old timers still remember when it was a complete shithole. But
yeah,
us youngins.
And it still looks like that on the outside. Like it's sort of leaning sideways a little, and the roof tiles aren't great.
Well, yeah, and all the water damage in the walls and stuff would mean that there's like random cracks in the walls, and like all the wood is swollen. The door is probably impossible
the
open.
Steps are all like. Bowed,
yeah,
as you go up the steps, but they would never fix it. It's like the character of the place, you
know? Sure,
right? It's like the opposite of a regular bar. When you get drunk, it all straightens out.
So how many guys do you take with you for the meeting?
I think that's going to depend on the flashback.
Okay,
but I think it should be us.
Fair.
And maybe like Cyclops and Hicks, like maybe a couple of our dudes, but I think this is a social gathering, not a we're sizing each other up. Yeah,
it is. Yeah. Okay, cool. So the six of you arrive, and there's the street is very active. It's this community area. A lot of Skovlenders here. Basho Vaz himself, his family is long ago from Skovlen, and he sort of is friendly to Skovlenders. You see some people that look like, to your eyes, as Duskwaldians. They look like refugees from the war, you know, but they're not like totally destitute. Like it looks like they've acclimated here. Maybe they got a hand up from the Lampblacks to kind of settle in Duskwall. But it's very busy street. There's like lots of street vendors and shops and things. But you can tell like every, you know, fifth stall or shop, there's a guy in a lamp black coat. They wear these like waxed coats, sort of brown cotton waxed coats that they used to wear on their job. To slick off the rain, and they have these big collars and stovepipe hats, some of them, and they really stand out. And they're not like giving you the stink eye or anything, but they're at war, and you can tell like they've got cudgels, and like one dude has like a two-handed sword. He's like stuck in the mud, and there's a guy with a pike, and they don't give you a second look. They don't give you any trouble at all, but they're clearly like full war footing, ready to repel people who try to, you know, come into their turf.
I think like kind of on that notion, we've just been sort of training together. So as we were walking up the steps, the Leaky Bucket, Cyclops is going to stick by my side, but Bricks and Eggs is just going to like peel off automatically. Like I just kind of give them a glance and they just sort of peel off and they stand at either side of the door. So they're just like there, you know.
Yeah.
You know, they're not causing any trouble either, but it's just like they're watching, and if someone was going to try and rush the place, they would be prepared to, you know, fend them off, let us know all that.
Cyclops like ducks up under the roof there. There's this like horrible drizzle happening if you're actually standing on the steps, and he sucks himself up underneath it, and there's a lamp black guard standing there with a cigarette, and just without pausing, he just like passes it over to Cyclops for a drag, and Cyclops like, oh, thanks. Thanks, buddy.
They all have the shit job. Standing in the rain.
You guys go in, and instead, you don't hear music, you don't hear tavern activity. They've cleared it out. It's empty. It's a big, sprawling place with booths and like a second level. And it's super old wood. It's like been polished down to a fine, you know, sheen. Mostly like dark greens and brown stains. Big old bar with a mirror behind, with every kind of whiskey and
God, this kind of place would be so like uncomfortable when it was packed, because it's like raining outside and cold, so everybody's like wearing their coats, and they come inside and it's like hot and also like damp in here.
Yeah.
Oh yeah. Man.
It'd be intense. Yeah, but once you've been in here for a couple hours and acclimated, you know,
it'd be so claustrophobic. Yeah.
Yeah, it's a really popular spot. I mean, everybody knows it. Like, if you're a person who's around Crowsfoot, like this is a great place to go, and they run it really well. It's a great place to get good music here and stuff too. But in here, like sitting at a table is about a dozen foot soldiers of the Lamp Blacks with a map of Crowsfoot out on the table and weapons piled up. There's like black powder grenades like stacked in a corner. And they're in their shirt sleeves, like drawing on the map and talking, and they kind of look up when they see you come in, and then one of them waves you towards the bar. And behind the bar is Bajra Baz. Everybody knows him. You've all seen him. He's pretty famous around here. Big, broad-chested dude with sleeves rolled up, suspenders, shirt unbuttoned. He's very hairy, very bearish dude. Big beard, a little floppy cap that he it's all like old and worn, and he's behind the bar.
Nice. Clearly tending, right? Because there's nobody here.
But... yeah, he's not literally like cleaning a glass with a rag, but basically that's
everything. That's how you can tell he's not really the bartender, because contractually every bartender in a fantasy setting has to be cleaning a glass with a rag when you walk in, or they're fired.
Yeah. Well, if this was Law and Order, he wouldn't even stop putting the glasses away while he's talking to you. Like, a murder, you say? No, he's got a bottle, a very fine Skovlander whiskey. The label is so faded you can't read it. It's peeling off the bottle. There's dust on it because it's been sitting on the shelf somewhere. And he has four... glasses lined up, four glasses lined up on the bar, and he gives you the nod of like, come on over.
Yeah.
So you do.
Yeah, I do.
And he undoes the cork and pours out four, puts the glass down. Does anybody drink before him?
As soon as the first glass is full, I drink. Like, yeah.
Yeah.
Down, or do you take it?
Yeah, it's like bottle up. As soon as he moves on to the next one, I've already like I'm done the first one.
So it's down. Yeah, it's gone.
Totally. Nice. I like give him a nod. I'm like.
Meanwhile, RC's like lifting up to like toast to him. You know, like go cheers, and like just sees this. Like that's
the moment. Like bam.
Well, I'm kind of hoping that if there's going to be a toast or like a ritual or whatever, he'll refill my glass. Like, I'm hoping this was a freebie, right? And it's also to show him, like, I don't give a fuck. Like, hey, you pour me a drink, I'm going to drink it. What?
Nice.
Yeah.
So he doesn't react. When you do that, he fills the rest. He fills his own, picks it up. Sean, let's make that engagement roll.
Awesome.
Find out how vulnerable Bajra Baz was to the slayer of his enemies.
Yeah.
Gratuitous slayer of his enemies.
He's very gratuitous, yeah.
Gonna slay your enemies, might as well be gratuitous about it.
Four out of six.
Four dice, I'll take it. We can't really modify the engagement roll.
There are some like unusual abilities here and there that do that, mm-hmm. but by default, you'd get what you get.
Yeah, that's fine. Yeah. Not that I would be complaining about four dice anyways, but
four's pretty good.
Just for, you know, the audience's sake.
Who has the upper hand here?
Yeah. Sweet.
Six. Nice.
Sweet.
So that means the plan goes the way you would expect it to go. There's no surprises. So I think in this case, it means that you have a tier two gang. He has a tier two gang. He's at war and you're kind of not.
Yeah. But like we haven't really established, you know, what we're all about. So I want to Kander's already slammed it, but I'm to the death of the Red Sashes. Like we don't know anything about how where we stand, but we know fuck those guys.
Yeah, totally. Okay.
So I just want that's the opening thing is fuck those dudes. And then, you know, we can go from here. So that's what I kind of want to toast to as we start the conversation.
I think in terms of Oscar, this red, you know, I see it as strips of cloth hanging off of me, except for one arm that's still free. And I think I walk up to the bar, and as he lays out the glasses, I don't even touch one. I just do this kind of weird little hop where I perch on a bar stool, almost like a bird, and perhaps my hand just moves, and the glass that he poured for me moves over, but I never touch it. I think that when we leave, it's just gonna be empty.
Nice. Totally normal.
Yeah.
Perfectly normal day.
Dude, anybody who lives in Dust Bowl is we got one of those too. my cousin, he talks to Gus too.
Oh my god. They have meetings where all the weirdos from every gang go to hang out.
Right.
They have a guy dressed like an alligator.
I mean, don't you go to your cult on Sunday?
No, so Bajo's not that oblivious, you know. He plays everything really cool, but when you do that, he gives you this little he raises an eyebrow at Oscar and then looks at RC for a reaction.
Yeah, I shrug. Yeah, that's our little cousin Oscar, right?
Shit, Oscar, I forgot to tell you.
Oh yeah.
The mirror behind the bar is set up to reflect taxidermy that's on the other side of the bar. There's this huge river eel that somebody got that's 8 feet long that they've taxidermied, and Deathland stag, which is a super rare crazy creature with 6 foot long antlers and shit. But you notice as soon as you come in, they're arranged so that in the mirror reflection, they form the sacred symbol of the empty vessel. It's one of the forgotten gods. So you don't know anything about them, but you've read every weird book, so you immediately are
you've seen that picture somewhere before.
Yeah. If you want to make a study roll, I can tell you more.
I would really like to make a study roll.
Go ahead.
You should do that.
Is there a devil's bargain?
If you want to be bald-faced about it, Basho will notice that you're...
I'm good for now.
Hey, I can't help but notice your occult IKEA picture of me. Ooh, oh, yeah. Yes. Killing it.
Nice. I didn't say that was a fortune roll to gather information, not an actual thing. So you notice that Basho places glasses with his right hand and pours with his left. And he does a thing with the bottle that's a little weird. He goes to pour and stops and then pours. There's a little break in what he does. And it just screams to you this is
ritualistic.
The practice. Yeah,
there's meaning to it.
He's
it's almost like pouring one out for your homies, but you're pouring air, so.
Yep, exactly. He's, if there's such a thing as a devout in the empty vessel, he's one. He's one of them.
Yeah, all right, cool.
Nice. What that means, you don't have your research handy right now, but you can tell that he's a believer.
Yeah, that this none of this is accidental.
Yeah.
What's his reaction to the toast?
You raise your glass, he raises, and Cantor raises his empty one, and he pours
Cantor,
and then reaches out and clinks, and he says, "May it be soon, and may their suffering in the next world be long."
I'm like, fuck him.
And then he reads the shit out of all three of you. This is Basha. This is what he does. And you may do the same in return if you want.
What does he do?
So he reads you.
Uh-huh. Is this the point where we go, nope?
You may resist with a resistance roll if you want. If you think you have the cojones to outmaneuver Basho socially, then instead of resistance, you can try to like turn the table on him somehow with an action roll.
So yeah. whether Cantor does this consciously or unconsciously, his whole purpose in situations like these is to be the brass band marching by while the other person is trying to listen to the more subtle cues for RC. And like I'm just like, hey, over here, asshole. I'm big, loud, and annoying. And I'm like doing things to distract from like any kind of like if he's going to notice a thing, the most obvious, I'm the attractive magician's assistant is what's happening here.
It's actually a teamwork maneuver you can do, Adam. You can protect someone by making a resistance roll on their behalf. You can step in and be like, no, I'll take the bullet. And that's kind of what you're doing.
That's right? What I'm doing. Yeah, for sure.
So awesome. Which of your teammates do you want to cover?
Well, what's the mechanical situation here? What are we?
So you're going to make a resistance roll using one of your attributes. We'll figure out which one it is here, depending on what you're doing.
Mm-hmm.
You're going to take 6 stress minus your highest die.
Okay.
And you're gonna shut down Basho's read of that person.
And this is insight, prowess, or resolve, not a skill. Okay.
Right.
Sure. Yeah.
Well, in terms of the context of this, like RC very much wants to know whether or not Basho's feeling about the red sashes is like committed enough that's going to be a distraction for him, and that's going to be leverage against him. So I absolutely want to figure out like, is us focusing on, yeah, let's kill the red sash, is gonna make him overlook the fact that we're just trying to take their spot. Like, because we absolutely we want to work with him, but like he's just gonna now have to contend with another gang in his.
So you're totally reading him right back.
I absolutely want to, yes.
The question is like, is Adam covering for you? If he isn't, Cantor, if he isn't, are you resisting first and then just doing your own read? Or are you going to like try to twist the conversation in such a way where you learn what he really thinks and he doesn't learn what you really think? Or is it more like, yeah, go ahead, try to read me. I don't care. I'm going to.
No, because RC's not great at it, but I'm going to try and twist the conversation around because I don't want him to figure out kind of our motivation yet. I want to stay a little like he's really established. We're unknown. I want to keep that for a little while.
So basically if Cantor covers for you, he'll protect you and you won't really have to twist the conversation. You can just read him while he's distracted.
Okay.
And then he'll read Oscar, who
it's good.
Will have to resist on their own.
I feel like that's probably fine, and that's what Cantor would do too, because he already thinks that RC is kind of a guileless goof, and that Oscar, no one's gonna be able to read Oscar. Oscar's unreadable. Oscar is a book full of gibberish. So here, man, read this book. No one knows what it means. It's full of weird symbols. Like it's cool.
It's all in Aramaic.
Yeah. Yeah, either that or Oscar will just be like, "Go ahead, read me."
Yeah.
You want to see behind the mask?
Yeah, like, well, actually, like, the human portion of my mask that my mask reveals looks like it's sleeping, and then it's just got a Leviathan eye. So, yeah. You know, he looks at me, I look at him. He looks at me, I look at him.
You're the dude that goes to somebody's wedding in, like, cosplay. It's like, what? This is what I like to wear to these occasions.
You're like, dude, don't you want to know what I really think?
Yeah. Oh, God. The guy that you're like, don't let him get started.
No, I don't. No.
Yeah. Okay, cool. Yeah, I'll try to block Adam, for RC.
What's it look like when you do this with Cantor?
I mean, I was saying, I don't know that Cantor does it on purpose. I think Cantor just likes being the center of attention and is using bravado to do that. So I probably like immediately set into like talking about how we're like the blood letters now, and like if you didn't know already, that's our name, that's our thing. And like,
yeah.
I tell him the story about, yeah, you know, it's like, we're called that because of this time that we, like, wrote this list in blood or whatever, this guy. Like, and, like, I've embraced the story as truth, right? Even though I know it didn't happen, it did happen.
And we told that fool he better write every name on that door.
Yeah, right?
Find him. Yeah.
And so I'm like, and that's our thing now. So if you, like, see somebody, like, you know, with bloody names on, that's like, we did that. And that's cool. We got to, like, we got a thing. Us. That's us. Yeah.
So, Adam, we always paint Cantor as a bit of a fool in these situations. Is that true? Like, does he come across that way, or is it really, like...
No, I think, like, the thing is, Cantor knows what's expected of a person in Cantor's position, right? And as his position changes, he's actually pretty good at adapting that. Like, if you give him 10 years and he's, like, the boss of a gang, he will act like the refined boss of the gang.
Yeah, I'm glad you said that, because... This thing keeps happening, which has been really funny, but because the four of us are not somewhat psychopathic criminals who live in an underworld where you intimidate people,
right.
We tend to think of it as somewhat comical that someone would act that way, that they would, like, throw their weight around and constantly be in someone's face and, like, act that way. But your characters do live in a world where that sort of behavior is totally normal and, like, effective to, like, constantly be like, what's your problem? You got a problem with me? You know, like, that to us, that's kind of like, gee, what's wrong with that guy?
Right.
But in this world, like, that's how you act, you know, you do that. That's a normal thing. So it's easy to constantly make that a little bit funny, but I think Cantor is, you know, he's a criminal. He's a tough dude who's constantly, like, putting himself out there. And we all know deep down you do that because you're insecure and you're afraid and everything.
Sure, yeah.
But in this world, that's how it is. You put up this front and you protect your fragile ego, yeah, by being a badass. And so, yeah, I think we always have to remind ourselves, like, Cantor isn't always a comic relief. Like, he yeah, actually is, like, a kind, well, of, I mean, scary. That's... If he came into the room right now and started doing this, we would not think that was funny at all.
Oh, exactly, yeah.
We'd, like, be, it's... like, oh, shit.
You don't want an unstable person who is, like, violent and aggressive and stuff, like, up in your face. And that's just how we show we're strong, right? And I'm trying to, like... It's interesting because there is this idea in like polite society that if somebody is, like, in a position of power, you don't do that to them. Like, you don't act like that. You're like, oh yes, Bajor, yes, you know what's going on. But I'm like, no, fuck that. Like, I'm a big deal. I know our gang's a big deal. And the only way I can prove that is by talking big, right? And being like, whatever, man, you have this fucking leaky bucket and shit, but, like, we're coming up in the world, so you better pay attention, like, take notice. And yeah, so all I'm really doing is just, like, bragging and being big and being like, this is what it is. I'm telling the truth. I'm just laying it down on the bar and being like, look, man, we're coming up in the world. You got to take us seriously. The fucking Red Sashes didn't take us seriously. Where the fuck are they? Right? Like, this could go good for you or this could go bad. And if we walk out of here mad, it's not going to go good for you. Right? Like, you want us on your side. And so, yeah, I'm just taking up a lot of space. So that
it's,
I'm...
It's unusual that, like, I was just looking at Bajra's write up here. He has charming as one of his attributes. Whereas, like, Mylara Clev from the Red Sashes, she has aggressive, and Lyssa is cold. Like, being charming is unusual in this world. Him, like, being social with you and being fairly normal is not the way gang leaders often are. They're more like Cantor usually. So
yeah, totally.
So this is something he's going to be accustomed to, and frankly, he's probably had deals with Lyssa that have gone very much like this, where she's been like, you know, like, this is... He's got to expect that that's how a gang leader acts. Tough.
Yeah. Yeah, the very first thing out of their mouth is like, fuck you. No, I'm not doing that.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, I'm giving him the script to play along with, because if he's distracted playing the game with me, it gives the other two space to operate. Right?
Awesome. Cool. All right. So let's start with the resistance then and see how that goes with Cantor.
Okay. So what am I rolling here?
I feel like it's...
It sounds like resolve to me. That's like,
I was looking at it. Could be any of the three, right? Like, insight into how these things go, prowess for negotiating them, or resolve to, like, stand up to somebody who Cantor probably still thinks is a bigger deal than he is, but won't admit it. Like,
all right, let's look at the rule and see if it helps us, because I think it says something specific that might help us here. Okay, you roll insight when the consequences come from being deceived or understanding something. Reroll prowess when the consequences come from physical strain or injury. Nah. Yeah,
no.
Reroll resolve when the consequences are from mental strain or willpower. So yeah, I could see insight or resolve here, both.
I get an extra die from insight, so if I get to choose, that's what it's going to be.
Cool. Yep.
Good.
Okay. All right, rolling three.
Six minus... Oh, it was on a six.
I know. All right, so I take three, right?
Take three stress, yeah.
Okay.
You take three stress and you cover for RC. I'll have to decide if Basho is the type of person who really wants to read Oscar or not. I'll think about that for a second.
Yeah.
So he tries... So RC says, like, to the deaths of the Red Sashes is a toast.
Yeah.
Basho tries to read her to be like, to understand how much you actually care about that. Like,
yeah.
Are you in it because you're their enemy? Are you in it for leverage? Are you... But before he can do that, Cantor just like completely takes over the conversation.
Right.
And they start engaging. And Basho kind of shifts gears. Like, he switches from being totally charming to like being kind of a gangster. Like,
yeah.
He plays back at Cantor and is like talking about, you know, death and murder and where you draw the line and how you don't let anyone fuck with you. And they get into this thing together where, you know, they're both kind of going like, yeah.
Yeah. And part of what I think I'm doing is like keeping him in that space, right? Like I've snagged him and I'm trying to keep him in the, cause then he can't use his charmingness and he can't be all fucking slippery. He's got to be real.
Yeah. Right? Well, assuming that's real, but I
mean,
like
when I say real, like real registered trademark of the Cantor Corporation, like it's, it's not like real, it's like being street real, like
Cantor real.
Yeah. All that, yeah, all that like slippery, oh, I'm going to get you drinks and we're going to like toast stuff or whatever, like fuck that noise, like it's not how you do this.
This follows very well on what RC wants. I'll tell you exactly what I want to do, but I think I'm not quite there yet. What I want to do is command obedience with my force of personality. I want to intimidate and threaten. I want to make it clear that he had better be our friend, or as Cantor has just made it clear, he will be our enemy. But I don't know if we're quite there. Yeah. I was like looking at command. I'm like, that's exactly what I want. It's all of the things, all of the descriptions are what I want, but I don't know if we're positioned.
If you want to make a desperate command roll, Cantor has given you the opportunity.
Oh, awesome. I totally want to make a desperate command roll.
You totally can. So, and let me explain why, because this is important to what Blades in the Dark is as a game. Like, the fact that you can do it as your opening move here is because Cantor covered for you.
Mm-hmm.
And because we just spent six sessions making you a tier two gang with a reputation for murdering people. If you had done this on day one, session one, it would have been a clock. It would have been a project.
This would be the point.
Get there, right?
Like, this would be the point, I imagine, where we would like get, if it was a show or whatever, we'd have a flashback to Basho having a conversation with like a trusted lieutenant being like, listen, boss, I don't think you should have these people up in our bar. They are crazy as fuck. Like, they're gonna kill somebody and you're gonna regret it. And he's like, no, I can handle it. And like, there's that scene of them arguing and then it, you know, cuts back.
Yeah. The last time they had a meeting with a gang, they left in a wheelbarrow.
Exactly.
Right.
Yeah. Awesome. Yeah. So it's desperate, but you can do it because you've actually earned the right to do it, I feel.
Awesome. And so, I'm super gonna do it. As they're like going back and forth, at some point I'm just like, so are you in? And I just act like they've made some kind of deal, like they've been talking and bullshitting, and I'm just like, so you're down then. And if he has any moment of hesitation or whatnot, it's that like, no, we've agreed. Like my, what I want to do is insinuate that just by kind of bullshitting with Cantor, he's already kind of fallen in line. I want to catch
him.
It would make him
look weak if he backed down.
Exactly.
So what specifically is your command? Like, what are you like forcing him to do here?
Yeah. So my command is to chop up the crow's foot with us, where we will, like as we're bullshitting about it, we will eliminate the Red Sashes, we will eliminate the crows, and we will take the crow's foot. It will be the two of ours.
50-50.
We split the crow's foot down the middle.
And it's the crows out too, not just the Red Sashes.
Well, I mean,
Well, Basha can focus on the crows. We'll take the sashes. The crows can be his issue. And then he stays the fuck out of our hair. This is not, you know, he's our boss and he owns the district. It's, this is going to be our turf and we're going to get along well. And it'll be fine, right?
That's a modification. I like what you're saying there, Oscar. Is that where you want to put? I mean, again, this is like part of the conversations that you're going to have that we don't see. So you guys have talked about this, like,
is it
we together take out the sashes and then we together take out the crows, or is it we take the sashes, you take the crows?
I mean, like, I feel like it makes more sense to just be like, let's deal with this red sashes problem forever. And then depending on how that goes, we can decide whether to keep rolling with Bajo or we can go to the other guys and be like, look, they're chumps, so.
It sounds like Arcee's asking for everything right now. She's like, we want the whole district 50-50.
Yeah. I mean, we can cut back to like, cause we talked about this, I think, two sessions ago. Like this was a plan. Like if this sounds too forward, we can certainly say, let's take on Red Sashes together and chop up their territory.
Well, and then negotiate. You can do it anyway, even if they don't think this is a good idea. Like you have
There's no situation in which Cantor will ever be like, no, that's too ambitious.
Yeah.
Like it'd be like, fuck it, let's kill the emperor. Let's get up in his peace and do this thing. I'm gonna be the king. It'll be great. Like, you know, like there's no
immortal. Yes. Kill.
Exactly. Fuck it, we got like a weird, we got a creepy wizard and shit. Do something about that, Oscar. Come on.
Oscar, use your magic.
Yeah, magic that guy.
What are you good for?
Exactly. I believe in you.
So, yeah, the only way that flashback matters is, did you guys agree to a different plan that Arcee is now throwing out the window, or are you all on the same page, I guess, is what we need to know.
I am fine with whatever Sean decides that Arcee is doing.
All right.
Like, is this a moment of, like, of Cantor being like, yeah, what you said, or being like, what? Yeah, what you said.
I think I'm gonna get a little. I think actually, if it's okay,
go hard.
If this makes sense, it's a devil's bargain. I think like Arcee just gets like, I don't know. This might not be a devil's bargain. Maybe it's just pushing myself, but like I think I do get carried away and just be like, yeah, we want it all. And I don't think I'm following the plan. I think I might catch us off guard by just saying I want it all right now. I don't think that like puts us in a risk other than that. Maybe Cantor's gonna say I'm an idiot later on, but
fuck no. I love this shit.
I think that's totally pushing yourself. I think a devil's bargain, if you don't want to spend the stress, would be to actually make explicit the bird man perched on the stool here and say something along those lines and be like, you know, yeah, we're gonna do this 50-50. Yeah, people have been disappearing. Yeah, the bloodletters, you know, it's not just that we're cold-blooded. Like, put it on the line. Like, yeah, Basho, all the weird shit you've been hearing,
that's us.
That's who we are. That's what we're about.
Oh, yeah, I say it. Because I'm not threatening your identity right now. You're the creepy rag dude. No. So, yeah, absolutely.
That's
right.
That's not common knowledge at all. In fact, like, Skurlock, no one ever says Skurlock. No one ever says the name or anything like that.
Yeah.
It's just... the weird shit that's going on.
Yeah.
And that hasn't been completely like tied together in people's minds.
Yeah.
But you have this opportunity if you want to be like, yeah, that for real, we're that's who we are.
Yeah. I'm not going to say the name Skurlock, but Arcee's got her fine military saber on her that's like cut through the tentacles of leviathans or hacked into them at the very least.
This is true of Cantor all the time, but I'm fully ready for this to become a gunfight at any second. To be like,
super important because this is an important role. Does I have 5 stress on me? Does anybody want to assist?
I can take it.
I'm looking at Cantor because Cantor.
Let me check. My stress situation is pretty high now.
You can't assist yourself, Sean. You're taking the devil's bargain.
I've got five stress as well.
Okay. I am going to be vicing next turn. Huh?
It costs 1 to help.
Oh, okay.
I'll take it because you're invoking me as part of your devil's bargain, and I will definitely take it. So I will assist.
Can the I don't know if this falls in your oeuvre of creepiness, but you know how like there's that image reflected in the mirror? Can we start seeing other fucking images of shit, like of people that are
The stools at the bar are all filled with ghosts.
Just in the mirror.
Yeah, just in the mirror, exactly.
Baja won't see it until one of his dudes looks up and goes like, "What the fuck is that?" Because Baja's facing away from it. So I don't know.
John, actually, I think I got this. I'm going to use Tempest to do this effect. But what happens is the mirror fogs over, and all of the things that were supposed to have been written on the door of the red sashes start being written in the mirror.
Oh my god, so good.
Red rum.
Red hand. Yeah.
That's awesome. Yeah, that's super good. And just as
come
as
and play with us, Baggio, forever and ever and ever.
My counterpoint, Oscar, you do that according to your own will and what you want, and then in addition, the fog like chills and frosts, so it stays. It's not just fog; it like ices, except where the writing is. And the ice is the black void sea water. Oh, not the ocean.
I was about to ask if we could do that because, like, a black mirror has a thing. So yeah.
Yeah. So at first it's fog and it looks like normal fog, and then when it solidifies, it just turns totally black.
Oh god.
Yeah.
I feel like we've succeeded just with that. Like, not. I don't know how we've affected Baggio. Just like that image is so metal. That's so awesome. Cool. Yeah. So. I like I said, I try to catch him off guard where he's like, or I'm like, awesome, you know, I'm like, we have a pact then. Together we take the crow's foot from everyone who stands in our way and we split.
50-50. So your command plus one for Devil's Bargain plus one for help.
Yep.
5 days?
5 days.
Crit that shit. Sean! Oh, Sean!
Oh my god. I rolled all the fucking dice. Oh my god, dude, I have
Sean, listen, your mother and I were not mad, we're just disappointed. Right? And
right,
we find out
how good the plan was by rolling the dice.
Yeah.
But I do it.
Yeah, I mean a four.
Four, got it. We did it.
Four, yeah, pulled your ass out of the fire at least a little.
Yeah. I just have
all sorts of ugly shit.
Yeah, it's desperate.
That's exactly what you wanted, John. That's exactly what you wanted. Was for this to go sideways in some way.
It's the best role, really.
It is.
Well, I take that back, actually. The 6-year would have been really good too, because they're all good, really.
Yeah. Well, and there's no way to post, like, even if we did a flashback, there's no way to, like, bump that. We bumped it as much as we could.
You do have options. As a Blades character, if you have one superpower as a Blades character, it's sucking up bad shit that happens to you. Like, that is your special ability.
Yeah.
So I'm going to say... it's not severe, so I get to choose. It's a desperate roll. It's severe harm, which it does make sense. Well, it could. I mean, he could have you like...
He could smash the bottle in your face or something.
Yeah. Severe harm, a serious complication. Yeah. Or and or a reduced effect or any combination of those that I want to do.
Yeah. I'm definitely buying off reduced effect. I will pay the stress. I'm not taking reduced effect. Like, if you throw that at me, I'd be like, cool, I'm resisting. Like, it's fine. But
yes, I am definitely throwing that at you.
Okay.
And I'm also throwing a serious complication at you, and you can decide if you want to resist both or one or whatever.
Cool. Well, let's hear them. I mean, so, I know what the reduced effect is.
Yeah, so reduced effect will be like he will tacitly agree to your plan here and now, and you can tell that he doesn't have intentions to actually form a real alliance with
right,
you.
Right.
Like, he's gonna be like after you, as soon as you destroy the red sashes, we'll destroy the crows. It's a deal.
Yeah.
You know, basically that kind of maneuver where
yeah.
Oh. he's not gonna stand against you because you succeeded. Like it is still a success. But his obvious move is to be like, you know what? You're right. You guys sound badass. Just go
to town. Right?
you know, and just not commit his own forces, right?
Yeah.
So that's the reduced effect.
Cool. I have an idea for resisting that. So that. Okay.
All right. And also, I should say that teamwork still applies. Like either Oscar or Cantor can once again step in to a result here, and you know, so you don't have to resist this all by yourself if you don't want.
I've got an idea for how to resist that. We'll hear about the other one, but
right. So the other is a serious complication, and that so. I love how almost every time we play, there's some sort of little lesson in role playing that we unearth, right? Because this is a secret. Like, this is a secret that I know that the players don't know, and they would have to like gather information and do projects and stuff to find this out. And their characters still don't know this, and they would still have to gather information for their characters to know this. But I'm gonna tell them because it's a complication here, and it's a thing that RC can be like aware of, or anyone can be aware of. I don't know, it's just interesting. There's this whole thing in gaming of like how you know, how you as a player know what's happening, how you filter it between what I know and what my character knows.
Sure.
And also like Adam often with Cantor does, where like his character certainly could know something and he chooses deliberately not to understand that thing.
Yeah. Or acts like he does. And there's that whole sense of like, what's the camera see? Like, exactly. What is it that the characters don't know? The audience knows? Like, who's the audience? How much are we the audience? How much are we the actors?
Yeah. So this is a good thing for prep too. Like, I've had this thing floating around for a while and it's always like kind of in play and not really on screen. And when am I going to drop it? And when do I want to use it? And you know, when a role like this happens, you're like, oh, well, this is a good time.
See, that's why I rolled like that, John, was for you to be able to unearn yourself that way.
Thank goodness for you, Sean.
No, thank you, Roll 20. That was fucking 5d6, 4.
So one of the guys at the table, looking at the map, one of Bajo's goons or lieutenants or whoever they are, you don't know any of the guys in his gang. One of those people works for the Spirit Wardens, and Basho knows this and uses it to his advantage as much as possible, and he isn't letting this person know that he knows. It's the Enigma code, you know, brinksmanship. We know where they're sending their submarines, but we can't act like we do. Then they'll know we broke the code, and you know, all that. So, when you lay all the cards on the table, like, no, we're the ones. We're the magical weirdness that's causing all this. This person tries, and like, this is why you can resist it. This person tries to surreptitiously leave. And go report to the Spirit Warden in Heartbreak Square to send their forces to take care of the problem. And Basho is going to let them. And what happens between the two of you, RC, because you don't know any of this secret shit, right? So what you experience is you can tell that he's willing to let you go forward without support. And you can tell there's a little sign in his eye. He makes eye contact with a dude, and that guy is like slipping out the back door.
And I have no idea what that means, but I know it's a cue. Cue.
You have a suspicion, and this is where I want to tip my hand a little bit and not keep it a complete secret. It happens exactly when you throw in the devil's bargain.
Mm.
Like everything's normal until you go that extra mile, and then you see the little glint in Basho's eye, and out of the corner of your eye you see this person packing it out the back.
We can do some secret eye glinting too. Fucking RC, give me that. I will bust several caps in this guy before he even gets to the door. You just let me know.
Currently both of those things happen. Basho like agrees, like pats you on the back, packs you out of his bar, and is like, good job, go destroy the red sashes, then we'll talk. And also some dude slips out the back and informs whoever he informs.
All right, so let's talk for a second as players about how to address these two consequences. I want Bajo to, I am totally ready to resist the reduced effect by going through some sort of ritual with Bajo, some sort of bloodletting, some sort of oath pact that people only take in like the most serious of ways, so he cannot possibly have, be like, this can't be a half measure.
You need a ghost contract from a spider.
That's my, sure, yeah, totally. I love the idea of Cantor going and like jumping that dude and being like, oh, it looks like you're not in with the plan. But
I mean, I have a
different idea. So, I think a flash, I can totally try and resist it with insight where I can put two and two together. And I can flashback to try and deal with it outside of the bars so that we don't break the peace.
Yeah. Well, if we were to out the guy to Bajo, if we were to be like, I think your dude actually works for the Spirit Wardens, even
Bajo
though he
knows.
No, but he's pretending like he doesn't know. Yeah, so yeah. Then he would have to axe his own dude because we just outed it publicly.
I don't even need a reason, man. I could just be like, look, I gotta take a piss, aka I'm gonna go and fucking ice this dude because RC gave him the fucking stink eye, and I'll come back later and be like, why did I shoot that guy 12 times? I don't, you like, seriously, you don't even need to justify it to Cantor. You just need to give me the, like, ice that guy, and I'll do it. I will follow him out. I'll be like, you two are, I'm done with this boring bureaucracy shit. You two deal with this. I have to go for 5 seconds. I'll be right back. Excuse me.
Okay, so we can have a Spirit Warden iced, or
no,
that's our ghost friend.
Just the tool of a Spirit Warden.
Yeah.
I gotta say, I'm a fan of the Cantor goes in the back to take a piss and shoots the guy in the face.
Yeah, all right. Totally.
I have also planned a, let's make a spirit bond to make this pact real. And that would kind of be you two handling the stress. Like, I mean, I was ready to just be like, no, let's be blood brothers and do the reduced effect. But, like, I'm totally happy to have Oscar make it real with some sort of spirit pact.
Yeah, you two do your spirit thing. RC, give me the secret PCI language, go kill that guy signal, and I will follow him out, and no problem.
Yeah. So can that guy kind of go out when the mirror is black, is it still reflective? Do we still see what's in the back?
Yeah.
Awesome. So, like, yeah, like, as I see it, like, I hear his chair get pulled out as he stands up or whatever, and, like, I see that there's a sort of eye contact and something's going wrong. I'm like, I just sort of look up and I look at the guy in the mirror, like, really pointedly so that Cantor can tell, like, I'm like, yeah, that guy's trouble.
Nice. Yeah. So, Cantor's going to resist that so this guy doesn't just vanish and tell his masters, so you have the opportunity to murder him.
Exactly.
Resisted murder.
Now, this role is to murder him. This is the role to have the opportunity to murder.
Because otherwise, I'll just go outside and actually piss in the alley and come back. Right.
Right. Like he's gone. If you don't resist the consequence, then you're like, where'd that guy go? I don't know. He's gone.
Yeah, he's
gone.
So
okay. So Cantor's on top of that one, okay. And Oscar, you're resisting the other one.
I guess I am.
I mean, aid in resistance? Because I'm happy
yes,
to make,
yes,
make
yeah.
So I'm happy to make the resist roll and have you aid with
thank
the spirit
you.
Pact.
Yeah. That would be actually you can't aid a resistance roll, but
wait,
I can
you,
pay to
really?
Do a small ritual that will actually contract us or something.
Can you really not aid resistance rolls?
That is correct.
Good
it boy. Is sad. Well, we can change it.
Hang on.
I don't know. Maybe I'll talk to the game creator about that.
Game design.
You assist another player with rolling. Describe what your character does to help. Take one stress and give them plus one die to their roll.
Yeah. It doesn't sound like you ain't working on resistance roll.
I will be happy to assist then.
Awesome.
I think, Strash, that might used to... I may have specified before that you couldn't, but I'm pretty sure that's gone.
Yeah. So, sounds great.
Awesome.
Let's do it.
Unless I'm missing the rule, I'm pretty sure you can assist any role.
Cool.
Yeah. So, which one am I going to do first? Because I think, like, they're going to happen simultaneously, obviously, but...
Yeah, whatever. How you guys want to do it, it's fine. Let's do canter first.
Yeah, let's do canter. I want to see.
All right, so you're gonna resist with your prowess, yes, Adam. You're gonna
You're
gonna intercept this guy by being a smooth motherfucker.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I gotta step outside and I do that.
Yeah. Cool.
Well, I mean, is it prowess or is it insight? Because
I was gonna say it sounded like insight to me, unless because
you're right. Yeah, because
you were getting a nod. Yeah.
I designed the fucking game. I get it backwards. You roll the thing you're resisting, not what you're doing. You're resisting being deceived, so you're rolling.
Correct. Yeah. Okay, so I got three dice for that.
Cool.
Nice.
So that should be okay.
Be good at role playing.
Let's see.
Hey.
Yep.
Only one stress, Adam.
Okay.
So we'll get to this in a second, but what happens is, like, during Cantor's, I'm being a thug speech, like, you get the vibe of a snitch, like, way before anybody else, you know? And you don't even know why. You're just like, something's wrong with this shit.
Yeah.
This guy just feels snitchy to me.
Yeah, I know what a fucking rat looks like.
I've been snitched on before, So I think you just leave and go into the alley and wait for whoever comes out.
Nice.
You're already there. You're like, oh, it's you. Okay, cool. Yeah. All right. RC, you are resisting with the bonus die.
Yeah.
And so you're resisting the deal, like, he's like, sure, go ahead, destroy the red sashes.
Yeah, and I'm like, we're in accord, and I tell me if this fits in like kind of with the ghost bond and the ritualized kind of thing. Is like I take my fine saber and I cut my hand and I little blood drop into his whiskey. And I like slide him the glass.
Yeah.
And I'm just like, you're going to drink my blood and I'm going to drink, like, I'm expecting he's going to do the same.
Well, and it's totally counts as help when you do this and he picks up the glass and like right here is a dude perched on the bar wearing a mask with a Leviathan eye. It's not like, let's shake on it. He's like, what am I actually drinking to right now?
Right.
Shit.
So I'm just like, I know he was doing a half measure and I want him to believe that this is absolute binding truth.
Yeah.
You know, to scare the shit out of him. Well, not scare the shit out of him, but make him realize there are massive repercussions to not.
Yeah, basically, like, you made your play, he played back at you, and you're shutting him down. Yeah. You're like, nope, that's not how it's going to go down. We're partners and we're going to seal the deal right now. Fuck you.
I think I'm resisting with resolve.
Yes, I agree. It's a question of willpower here, I think.
Yeah, so I'm going to roll 3d6. All right. I can take 2 stress. So 2 stress. Nice. I take it.
Nice.
Thank you, Oscar, for making that real.
So just to be clear here, unless you want to push the issue, Oscar, which you are in position to do, this may be your only chance. So you tell me how this goes. He does not drink the bloody whiskey. He sees the fucking whisper like 2 feet away from him. And he puts the glass down and he's like,
no, he doesn't. Like, literally,
hey, wait, let me tell you. And then you revise it. He wants to put it down and go, fair is fair. Fair is fair. You got me. We'll be partners. We'll take him out together. And he's totally earnest. Like, he's completely sincere, but he does not want to drink the blood whiskey.
Right. And RC and Strush, you totally can remind us, but RC is like happier with that because she just wanted to like get him real.
You totally called his bluff, and he's like, "You were right."
he'd rather actually do what we want than drink the weird juice. Yeah, I feel for him, and in this moment, I understand about
you. You know what? We're a group of fucking sociopaths and weirdos. So if Oscar like steps this up,
so Strush, what happens instead of that?
I don't think it's that he goes to set it down and he's I can see the wheels turning and the speech is forming in his mind and like it just doesn't move. And then you realize that one of the like little metal claws or something that's on my hand is there, and I just keep pushing, like the glass stops, and then it starts going this way. I'm tilting it, like nope.
You're gonna, like, physically, like not. You're gonna, like physically be like, no, you have to do this.
Actually, I'm kind of making now, because Baja Baz probably has like 300 times my muscles. Like he's.
Oh yeah, I'm not saying you're gonna force.
He's way stronger. But what I'm saying is I'm making this like a point. Like he's like, yeah, I'm not really comfortable with this. And I'm just like, this is my way of saying, what, are you a coward?
Yeah.
You're like, if you're really in it with us, this is how you're in it.
That's right. And, well, and like, there's even this point where I've got that like one eye asleep and my squid eye like looks at the arrangement of the like things and then looks at the bottle and then looks at him and he kind of gets like, this is our ritual. You're just gonna like,
right. You took it from like, I just was trying to like up the ante to now like, no, this is what the bloodletters do. The bloodletters drink each other's blood. And that's what we do.
That's right. That's what the bloodletters do.
Wow. Okay.
I feel like you're trying to command him.
Yeah, I do too. I mean, this is an ultimatum. Now, there is another way to do it, Strash, if you want to.
I'm listening.
You can make a resistance roll.
Yeah,
you can because this is part of the deal. Like if this was happening out of nowhere, if it was like, let's go to Basho and make him drink this blood, then it would be command or skirmish or something like that. But instead, like, this is a consequence of the action. It's less a action and more of a consequence. So you can always resist consequences, and the consequence is he caves to RC's bluff and doesn't drink the blood. And you, if you want to, you can use teamwork and you can step in and go, no, nope, I'm going to resist that. And just like you said, I make it an ultimatum. If you want to call RC's bluff, you got to drink blood. And that's a resistance roll if you want to make it. Otherwise, you have to let the situation die and be done and then like force him to drink it by some means.
No, I'm good with that plan.
Okay.
Yeah.
My resolve is firm.
You okay.
Yeah, I'm happy to help you as well.
does RC be like, oh?
Well, my help. Well,
I drink first.
I just feel like we're like in this, and my help is like, like when you say no, like when you force it, I'm like, having power comes with cost, and I'm just like, that's apparently what we do now. So
we. I would like to point out that we are, at this point, changing our gang's reputation slightly.
Yes, you certainly are.
We're going to earn XP for it. Great.
I'm taking a resistance roll for RXP.
Let's do it. You are. We added a reputation last time. I think you have two now.
RC, would you like to assist?
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. That's my assist, is RC going.
All right, John.
So, this Sean, is a resistance roll. Take one stress, Sean.
Yep.
RC, Oscar, you get a bonus die.
So I'm going to roll resolve unless you have a different.
No, resolve is perfect. Yeah.
Fantastic. Here it goes.
Nice.
Oh! Nice.
Drink that blood, motherfucker.
So I would like to point out that when you crit on a resistance roll, you clear a stress.
Yes, you do.
Nice.
Minus one stress.
Sweet.
Nicely done.
Flip flopping it. You're the best.
And it happens exactly the way you said, Strash. Like, he's like, okay, we'll throw in together. And the claw comes up and just hovers there. And he looks at RC, and RC's like, gotta do what you gotta do. Yeah. And because John, you have your bloody glass too, right?
Yeah, well, yeah. My thought is...
It's not just him. Like, you're doing this with
him. He's got to participate, because my thought is, I cut my hand and I drop it in his glass. He's drinking my blood.
Yeah.
My expectation is like, my glass is right there. Like,
he's going to do it back.
Yeah. Right. Yeah. Like we're drinking on this. Like I'm absolutely doing it.
So
we're creepy, weird fuckers. I'm not drinking Leviathan blood.
He has the glass like this. He reaches into his waistcoat and he pulls out this like Bowie knife, this like 2.5 foot long Bowie knife that he just has concealed in his waistcoat. Now that's a knife. And he's got the talon here, so he doesn't move it at all. He just slides it forward over your glass and then slashes himself on the hand, so it drips into your glass. And he doesn't look at Oscar Deering in this at all.
Yeah,
he's not like petrified or anything. He's not that type of dude, right? But
he's seen some shit.
He realizes who he's just getting into bed with.
Yeah,
and this is the cost of doing business. And he tried to use his charms to play it off, and that shit did not work.
Yep.
And maybe you guys haven't done the legwork to know this, but I think you just found out he does in fact still have weak hold, just like you. Because if he didn't, he would not be doing any of this shit. and so he's like, Basho, you gotta do what you gotta do, man.
You gotta team up with Marlo and his crazy psychopaths.
That's right. So he doesn't say anything. And he's still like, he smiles, and he clinks your glass with the blood droplets in it, and down the hatch.
The blood dropping into the whiskey glass is totally one of those like interstitial bits in the credits that we didn't have context for until now, right? Like now,
totally.
Like, everybody's already seen this exact shot over and over and over, and then they're finally like, they're like, oh, that's where that's from.
That's
like
the beginning of Deadwood. It's like the horse running in the mud, and yeah.
Oh, that's so good.
That's so
yeah,
good.
That and it's a super CGI'd effect too. Like when the blood hits the whiskey, it like really just balloons out. Yeah.
And only Oscar sees that it turns black in the glass.
Yeah.
And you guys drink it down.
Yeah.
Satara cannot be kept out of any of this bullshit. Everything that happens, she immediately is a part of.
Nice. Thanks. I love it.
Meanwhile,
but surely.
That's right. Meanwhile, a door bangs open in the alley, and this dude comes out and like scans around and sees Cantor standing there. Do you have your gun out? Are you like waiting for him with your pistol?
Yeah. I've got both my pistols out, and I probably don't even. There's like I get a one liner in before I just shoot the dude, and I'm like, where are you going?
The rain is like pouring down on you, you know, and you're there with your guns.
Yeah, he stops. So you're muted, Strash, if you're saying something, or if you're just pantomiming. I can't tell.
Sorry. I just have this vision of you standing with both guns out, and you're like, one night is sup.
Yeah, I mean, he comes out, and yeah, I'm standing there in my coat and my hat, and there's like rain pouring down on me, and I got both guns, and he steps out and looks at me. I'm like, where are you going, man? Party's not over yet. And I just give him both barrels. Yeah.
Kablam.
Yeah.
So a thing Cantor would know, it just occurred to me, but a thing Cantor would definitely know, because we made this whole premise, is that there's lamp blacks all over the place.
Yeah.
So that's going to get heard unless
it depends on how good Adam is at role playing, right?
I mean, that's true.
If he rolls a six, fine.
I time it exactly as a peal of thunder tears across the sky.
Love it. I love it.
Exactly. Yeah. And that's why this is a risky role. Like it's not risky because.
Well, I guess I mean that's actually I guess that's actually like a feasible thing because what is it like? Yeah. How many sec? There's like a period of time between the lightning and the thunder, right? So lightning illuminates the alley. Oh, I'm like one, two, bam! Awesome.
That's pretty amazing.
That is fucking.
So Adam, you can choose here. I think. So this is a chance to use the hunt ability, which we haven't really used much.
Yep.
Obviously, you're hunting this dude.
Totally.
And that would make it extremely clean and like keep you at a remove from the situation because, you know, you shoot him when he comes out the door or you wait for him to run down the alley and then like plug him in the back or something.
Mm-hmm.
Or you can use your skirmish and like personal with this guy and like as he comes out you like attack him and
I think what I want
jam your gun under his jaw and blow his brains out.
I think what I want ideally is to take the I'm gonna take the stress for the extra die and I'm waiting out here and what we don't see is Cantor like having that moment of like what if I shoot this guy and he's just like out here to like he's not a snitch. What if like he's trying to struggle with his own like innate sense of like something's up versus
interesting.
Right? Like I don't think we see that. I think we just see the cool Cantor, but what's going on inside is like, okay, if I'm gonna do this and I kill this guy, what if he ends up being like Basho's like, best buddy, then I'm gonna have to ramp up all the other shit way harder, right? Like, I know that this is a...
He is a lamp lamp, and yeah, you're exactly. in his turf, and you're murdering him. Like, it's a very risky...
I'm also really hoping that there's something to prove on him if I do, like, fail, that I can be like, look, see, I was right. Like, he's got, like, a letter or whatever.
A bronze mask?
Just gonna cross my fingers and hope.
Yeah, right? Because I know, and, like, Cantor doesn't need to convince himself. He knows that this guy's a no-good fucking rat, and that wherever he was going was gonna be bad. I could feel it.
You 100% got that vibe.
Yeah. No, I know. Like, I know for sure. But he's thinking about, like, I'm gonna have to prove it, or if not, I'm like, amping myself up to go in, like, double, or triple, quadruple hard on fronting, right? When I'm like... So what, I shot this guy, what? Like, he's a rat, I fucking know it, you know it, motherfucker. Like, I have to go big, and I'm kind of like amping myself up for that, too.
And it's a one-sided story, too. You're not capturing him and forcing him to talk, you're just killing him.
Yeah.
Like, it's a complete, well, I guess maybe his ghost could talk, but...
Exactly. And that's, you know, I mean, and that's what happens, right? Like, Arcee does the setup, Cantor takes the action, Oscar fixes the problems that Cantor doesn't know exist.
Yeah.
And we just fucking repeat ad nauseum. It's good.
That's why we're a killer team.
Yeah, that's right. Like, and I think that crosses my mind that I'm like, even if nobody believes me and even if there's no evidence, Oscar will do something. Like, he'll just be creepy and it'll work, right?
Oscar will clean it up.
Yeah, Oscar will clean it up.
Our messes.
Oscar, make it go away with your magic. Yeah. Teleport us to the moon.
Get me out of here, Mr. Wizard. All right, cool. So I've got...
So hunt it is.
Yeah.
You're gonna stress.
Yeah, I'm gonna push it. So I got 3 days.
I don't think anyone can help you there in their own little world.
No, yeah, they're doing a thing. That's fine.
I think we could in a flashback.
Okay, sure.
And the flashback would be this, would be cut back to, you know, how we had our dudes peel off in the front.
Good one. Good one, Sean.
Just be like, okay, as soon as everything settles down, go around back or distract them. Whatever you like better, Kendra. Whether you want like a dude to hold them or whether you want like them.
No, all I really need is like body cleanup detail. Like if I suddenly need this guy disappeared, then it'll be nice to have Cyclops there to be like, okay, go find a river to throw this guy in.
And maybe he's also like at the end of the alley, so the guy like pulls up short.
Mm-hmm.
And you're behind him.
He doesn't even face me initially. He comes in the alley, turns around, sees Cyclops, is like, what? And Cyclops is looking past him at me. Guy turns around, and that's when
I'm like,
nice. So like, yeah. So what's the how unlikely is that?
I'm fine with rolling that into the stress cost for the help. I just one.
Okay, cool. Then yeah, I'm gonna take.
I mean, that's completely in keeping with A. You specifically had a training scene about tactics with these guys.
Yep.
And B. Like they're doing the thing. Like they're not. It wasn't like, oh, I trained with them earlier, and now they've rigged a complex series of ropes, you know, or something. Like they're doing the exact thing that you trained them.
Cool, awesome, yeah, my boys,
nice.
All right,
nice.
So I got 4 days total.
Cool.
We're starting to seem competent. This is no longer yakking sense.
It's a risky roll, risky position.
All right, I got 5.
Close.
Yeah. We're seeming competent.
You do it. You activate murder systems on this guy.
Mm-hmm.
Let's talk about the effect. Oh, no. The complication is way better here.
Yeah.
All right, Adam. I got a question for you. I got a 7-9 for you. So this guy, he comes out. Cyclops stops him short, like we said.
Yeah.
He sees him and he wheels around to face you. Then out of the door comes another lamp black. And he sees you. He sees what's happening, and he steps in the way.
Mm-hmm.
And you shoot him down, and then you shoot the other guy down.
I got two guns, so it's like instead of shooting one guy twice, the other guy steps out, and I'm just like.
Now, if you want to, you can resist that consequence with a resistance roll. You can use your prowess, and like the guy's like no, and you just shoot around him, and like don't don't kill the other lamp.
Bend your bullets.
I mean,
shoot with it. Or you just like bam.
Yeah,
bam.
I mean, like one body, two bodies. Like fucking guy's probably here to check on his fucking snitch friend. So,
well, one of them is guilty and the other one isn't.
You say that as though Cantor sees a difference between guilty or not guilty.
I'm asking a question.
Yeah, totally. So there's two people getting shot here. There's the snitch and there's a consequence of being friends with snitches. Right. And that's it. This is how it's going to go. All
right. That's how it goes down.
Keep in mind that if you drop him, you can point out, like, you have corroboration for your story.
Yeah. Well, no, look, we got a dead snitch, and we got a lamp black who was a hero who knew this other guy was a snitch, and like, oh, look, they shot each other. I was just pissing in this alley.
We need to get some CSI shit in here.
Cantor, let the bodies hit the floor.
Yeah.
He's got gunpowder residue on his hand.
It's raining. It all washes off. But no, actually, I think that's like a passable, like, yeah, like, this guy was obviously a snitch. This other dude, I'm going to have to pat them both down. But, like, obviously, this other dude knew and came out here, and they just shot each other. It's fine.
But to do that, you won't be able to take credit for it, though, again.
Cyclops knows what's up.
It's true.
He's only got one eye, but he saw.
Man, when one of your characters dies, Cyclops is totally going to be a PC. Yeah. He's like right there.
Hovering around PC area, yeah. Yeah, no, I'll just do them both and be like, cool. That's how it goes.
Yeah, so there's rules for effect here, but you're well within the killing range of effect, so we don't need to parse it all out and figure it out.
Sure.
So yeah, bang, bang, they both go down. Now, it's not instant. They gurgle in the muddy alley for a second and bleed out and, you know, one of them is like, fuck you. And the other guy's like, my spirit will haunt you or whatever. And then they die.
Can like, so that they can't yell, is it okay if Cyclops just like turns one of them and like pushes his face into the mud? So he just like burbles like into the mud and it like sputters.
That is what Cyclops would do. He gives zero fucks about everything. Like from the very first day when RC threw him down the stairs, he's just like, I don't know, whatever.
That's how it's going to be.
I'm going to do whatever I got to do. I don't know.
Yeah.
Cool. Yeah. Bang, bang. And the complication I didn't choose to use was the lightning and the sound and stuff. So like,
yeah.
you do it well, like the sound of the street, business and stalls and everything, like nobody, they hear the gunshots, but no one's like, oh my God, gunshots. They're like, whatever.
Right. Yeah.
Did you hear a gunshot? Yeah.
Yeah. It happens. It's fine.
I want to check to see if there's anything unusual on the guy that was giving me the snitchy feelings.
See, I have no idea, so let's find out.
Seems like a fortune roll.
Bronze mask.
It is totally a fortune roll. Let's make up a trait. So this is how you could do a fortune roll. Let's say that a high roll means evidence. So let's make up a trait of like sloppiness for this guy. Like,
yeah,
how sloppy was this dude?
Right.
He had to be a lamp black and be a spirit warden, which was fine until the spirit wardens moved into the district. And then he had to like switch on the fly between his two roles.
Sure.
Is he the type of dude who is willing to walk all the way back to his apartment every time?
Right, to get his mask.
To get his shit.
Awesome.
Or is he the type of person who would just carry it with him because that makes it his life a lot easier?
Is this guy a lazy jackass? Never doubt it.
Well, I would posit that Bajo has already figured it out. We know that.
Yes, RC has a good... like feeling that Basho knew something was up with this person.
No, I don't mean our characters know that. I mean, we've established.
No, I mean, RC knows that Basho knows that this guy was up to something. You picked up on that.
Got
you know about the spirit wardens and shit.
Right.
But the thing is, it could have been anything, right? Like Basho, like from what RC knows, Basho could know that this dude is going out to like have sex with somebody else's sister in the gang, right? To be like, okay, right. I won't tell this guy about, right? Like,
well, he has something. That's not totally true because I did say that.
Right, it was triggered by
It was triggered by the thing that she said.
By the mentioning.
So I'm going to say sloppy, but not crazy sloppy. Like, sloppy enough that Bajo could figure it out, but maybe not sloppy
enough. Well, no, but the question is, did Bajo figure it out, or did the guy tell Bajo, right? Like, is the guy trying to play both sides against each other?
No.
We established that Bajo was pretending like he didn't know that the guy... Or not we established, sorry. John said that Bajo figured it out, but hadn't let the guy know he figured it out.
Yeah.
Because he didn't want to tip.
So obviously the guy's like, I mean, whatever, we're smarter than
fucking Bajo. But let's just figure out the evidence here. I feel like if he was the best spy possible, we would give him zero dice of sloppiness and you'd roll and take the worst one. If he was the worst spy possible, we'd give him six dice. Because he was just fucking awful. And if he was, so he can't be the best spy ever because Bajo knows.
Yeah,
that he was doing him, and he can't be the worst spy ever
because nobody else seems to. Yeah,
the spirit wardens have their pick of dudes to spy for them.
Also you got to remember the tier we're on, right? The spirit wardens are using their better dudes for bigger games. Like, this is just Basho Bass, right? Like, we're still down at the bottom of the pile. So the spirit wardens are like, I don't know, don't send 007.
Yes, okay, Adam, that's perfect. Let's say for tier 4 operations, they use sloppiness zero guys.
Yeah, right.
For tier 3, they use one, and for tier 2 with you guys, they have two. They're two dice of sloppiness.
That's what I was thinking. Yeah.
Yeah, that's what I was thinking too.
That's the level of dude they assign to a tier 2 problem.
So
on a 6, you get a completely unambiguous piece of evidence that definitely says this guy was working for the Spirit Wardens.
Roll a crit and have him have like a mission from that.
Yeah, he'll have like he'll have intel on him.
He becomes the classic RPG dead guy with a letter from the head of the Spirit Wardens.
Yeah.
Where's the next score? Roll a crit, we have a new score on the Spirit Wardens.
On a 4 to 5, he'll have, like, debatable evidence. Like, most people would agree that it's pretty, like, fairly... Like, maybe he has a mask. Like, well, okay, like, that's debatable.
Yeah.
And on a 1 to 3, you pat him down and, like, he just doesn't have anything on him to help your cause.
Okay. All right, so I'm rolling two dice.
Two dice. The sloppiness of the spy.
Be a good role player.
Oh! Good at role playing, Adam Cole.
Yes.
It was I don't know what you guys see on the animations, but it was a 3 and it tipped over.
Yeah.
Yes, for me too.
I love that we all get the same animation. That's really good.
Yeah.
Good job, Roll 20. Dude, awesome. Yeah, so you pat him down and he has like, he hasn't turned in his logbook for the week. Like, he was supposed to turn it in and he hasn't turned it in yet. So he doesn't have a mask because he's not an actual spirit warden, but he has this little notebook written in a fairly simplistic code that Oscar can break it easily. It's like shorthand or something like that. It's a record. He's like writing all the shit down to turn into the Spirit Warden Commander for the week. And it's got his, like, operator number in it and all that kind of shit.
And I'm a better spy than this asshole.
Yeah.
So are you going to come back and be like, I cleaned up your mess, Basho? You had a leak?
Yeah, so obviously what happened here was that me and... So I'm going to take one of my pistols and I'm going to... put it in the hand of the... Does the guy I shot, the regular lamp, like, does he have a pistol?
Yeah, he does, yeah.
Okay, all right. So I'll put his pistol in his hand, and I'll put one of mine in the hand of the... assuming the warden doesn't have his own. So it looks like they shot each other.
No, yeah, the spy has one, too.
Okay,
they're,
cool.
They're all kitted out for
one. Yeah, yeah, okay. Yeah. And it's wet and stuff, so I probably like tamper with them a little so you can't tell if they were fired or not, right? Because it's raining.
Yeah,
and they fell in the mud and stuff.
Trivially easy to do.
Yeah. So I put their guns,
don't have fingerprinting in this world.
So yeah, I put their guns nearby and I tell Psychops, I'm like, all right, this is what happened. Motherfucker number one came out here to go rat on us. This guy came outside. They shot each other. Bing bang, problem solved.
Yeah, Psychops is like,
so we just leave the bodies. You go run back to the front door. You tell them what happened. I'm going to take this book. I'm going inside, and I'm going to clear this up with Bajo.
It's a tragedy.
Yeah, real fucking tragedy. And I go back inside.
All right. you come back in drenched, dripping on the floor, and everybody looks up at you, and then they're like, oh, it's that guy.
I do what I just did, where I wait until there's like, I hold by the door, and I like wait until there's like a flash of lightning, and I'm like, one, two, and then I push the door open, so I get some thunder when I come in. Yeah. Nice. I play it up, so I'm like, gonna like open the door, I'm holding the book.
And so, Oscar, you and Arcee, you see it, like, across Bajo's eyes. He sort of looks up, like, concerned, but you see it pass. Everything happens right behind his eyes. He's like, I saw that dude. He left. He ran out in the alley. I think I heard something a little while ago. Now Cantor's walking in. And, like, he doesn't need anyone to tell him what happened. Like, he immediately is like, mm-hmm. Like, his face doesn't change, but you see it all just go click. He knows exactly what happened.
Is that the moment when we are taking the shot? Is that like before we're like, yep.
Drink down the whiskey.
Cool.
And Cantor, you walk up with the wit.
Well, I think what happens is we get the sort of three simultaneously, like, you drink, and then as you put your glasses down, I throw the book down on the bar. Nice. And that's probably like cut to credits for the end of the episode. And we end there. That sounds good.
Mm-hmm. Love it.
Nice.
Cool. Let's get some XPs.
Yeah.
Let's do it.
Sweet. We kind of have two things to determine.
Actually. Man, we're getting good at this. The blood letters are getting sweet.
You are getting quite good. We need to know, is this a score? Did you actually like make deals that paid you out tonight? In terms of reputation and coin, or is this a setup for a future payoff?
I feel like we definitely did it in terms of rep, because
no coin for sure, but
we took the blood letters from, maybe these are some guys, maybe that's a thing, to holy shit, the blood letters had just said, outed themselves as, you know, we're the creepy fuckers that have been abducting people or doing whatever with people, and we are also at war with the Red Sashes, and we are also going to take the Crow's Foot to, you know, a room full of Flint Blacks.
So I think that we can frame it this way. I think that rep would definitely come in from this job because it is a job. I think that we might get less cash than normal. Like, it's not an average score, it's a small one. But I think in the credits, what we see is Lamp Blacks and our gang beating up some Red Sashes, and that's where the coin falls out of. What do you think?
Yeah, so we're effectively rolling in like stage one of the turf war. I agree. I think, I mean, if we were not playing once a month for 2 hours, like this road might be a little bit steeper.
Right.
But I think it's okay.
I love Strash's idea of the, like, the episode would have been like filmed like a little longer than usual. So we get over the credits, just like montages of like Arcee and Cantor like kicking doors in and shooting Red Sashes.
Oh, like, and, like Cyclops like punching someone. And
Yeah, there's like a Red Sash that like wraps their sash around Cyclops' neck, and a Lamp Black cuts it off and hits the guy, and they look at each other like they're like, you know.
Nice.
Right, establishing both the passage of time and the change in the political landscape. I like it.
Yes. Because you mentioned coin, that reminded me, we have a vice den, so in our last downtime, that should have generated us coin. So we should have rolled two dice minus our heat.
You're totally right. We skipped over that.
And our heat is one.
Our heat was one, yeah. At that time. Back to that time. Because that's a full.
The heat is one.
The heat is one.
The heat is one. I can never play this game without getting that song stuck in my head. Like, it's never happened every time.
Who wants to roll the vice in? Let's do it now.
Yeah.
Adam, roll the vice in real quick.
I used up all my powers. All right.
It's okay. Right. If your power is not great, we won't play.
So what am I rolling? 2D6.
2D6.
Yeah. Just two.
Yeah.
Okay. All right. Boop. There you go.
Oh yeah, Adam Coble, everybody. it's minus the heat, minus one. So
minus one. So
five coin from your is that right?
Yeah, that's what right. That's what your thing says.
That is a hell of a
minus heat.
It's a hell of a mechanic. All right, cool.
So that's more than we can fit. I think we have to take it personally or drop it or something.
You can distribute it personally. We have plenty of room.
Yeah. So
how about we put two in the bank for right now, and we each take one.
That sounds good.
Okay.
Well, the bank
that,
is up.
That clears me up from the one that I spent.
Yeah. Same here.
Mine's going in. I'm gonna put my first coin in a stash.
What?
Oh, nice.
You think Oscar has a future? That's adorable.
It has to do with lifestyle as well.
No, you're right. It's just going into my coin. You're right.
Why have a stash, Oscar? Come on, let's get real.
Oscar needs a stash so that he can like be in a sweet mansion, just so that when he says like that's I am true. Oscar Scurlock, everyone's like, oh.
That is why. That now explains why Lord Scurlock's manor is such a shithole.
Yeah.
No, there's no stash.
I am also putting no one in stash.
Okay, cool.
I'm up to three in stash. Archie's secreting it away.
All right, so obviously that is your ongoing coin from your tattoo parlor and your drug den, which we skipped over, so that's cool.
We'll get heat, so it's not going to be so much coin next time, which is why I want to cover operation.
Let's do it in order. So first order is payoff. So you get one rep per tier of the target, which is Basho in this case, so two rep.
Nice. Our rep, I have us marked as having three rep.
Yes, I do too.
Oh, okay, yeah. So that was even after the rep cleared from us going up a tier. Yep. So we're up to five rep now.
Up to five.
Cool.
Then the coin from the initial.
So are you, Strash? Are you okay keeping track of our gang stuff? Because there's no playbooks built into the Roll20 thing yet for.
Sean has been the master. Oh, I'm mostly second checking.
Okay. Yeah, I've been keeping it up.
Okay. All right, good.
Thanks. I just want to make sense.
I'm trying to do that too, but that's good, Sean. The coin is tough. So I don't know. Like it's like I like this idea that there's this little montage of like the two gangs teaming up and knocking over some of the Red Sashes, drug dealers and stuff as like an initial, you know, maneuver. And we see them working together, and we see them like spilling the strong boxes in the drug den, you know, and splitting up the profits and stuff. I think seems pretty reasonable. Like,
I think that's good.
Two would be like a really minor job, and the Red Sashes are bigger than that. So
well, but really, we're also splitting it. Like,
well, four is great. Four is a strong box. So we get one, they get one.
How about we do? Let's pretend that it's a six coin standard score, and you split it.
Split it, okay.
So it's three for you guys.
So again, that's gonna push us over.
Just each one of us takes a coin. We're good.
So yeah, I say each of us takes a coin. Yeah, that's thinking too.
I'm laden with coin.
Yeah, you guys are getting personally a little wealthy here.
Yeah, I'm putting that in stash as well.
Nice.
Actually, I am now full on coin, so after this, it's going to go in stash.
Yeah, that's how I'm going to handle it too, I think.
Okay, so second we do heat. Smooth and quiet, low exposure. There was a quiet meeting in a place that Bajo controls. So that's one heat. Add plus one heat for high profile target, not really. Plus one if it happened on hostile turf, no. Plus one if you're at war, no. Plus two if killing was involved.
Yeah.
Heat three.
Yeah, because that spy is not going home now.
Yeah.
He is not going home.
Oh, well, and he's very close to that Spirit Warden rookery.
And they did bring it in to look for shit like this. So
it's heat three, and then it's immediately going to be minus one for...
Right. So we're a total of heat three then, because we were heat one before.
Yeah.
Okay.
Entanglements I'll do later, and then downtime next. So... we can do XP.
Yeah.
Sweet.
Who wants to go first?
Do you want to go first, Arson?
I went first on the and the downtime. Let's flip it.
Flip it. Oscar, yeah, you go first.
All right. I don't think I rolled any desperate actions, did I? Nope. So when I address tough challenges with arcane power and knowledge.
You should take two XP for that, because even though what you did in downtime, you know, wasn't like a lot of attune rolls and stuff, like it should be worth 2 XP to you. Yeah. Because it's worth way more than that to me as the GM. So
right, you gave Satara like a key to your apartment, and
agreeing to shake hands with Satara may not seem like addressing a tough challenge with arcane knowledge, but it totally is. So yeah,
blue upwards arrow.
All
right, cool. And then the next thing down is at the end of the session, if you've expressed your beliefs, drives, heritage, or back background.
Yeah, for sure. Both background and drives. I would say too. Again, I mean, your background as a noble and your drive for the demon stuff is causing a lot of important shit to happen, even though it's not like front and center with the gang. You gotta take 2 XP for that.
So this is an important question. Yeah. This last one, it says, mark an XP if you struggled with issues from your vice or traumas. And I have a trauma, and my trauma is reckless. Mm-hmm. And the place where I tried playing that up was when I wouldn't let Bajo Baz.
Totally agree.
Not yep. participate.
Yes, I super agree.
Take a bonus XP for that.
Which means that I am going to get a thing. So we'll figure out what that thing is.
It's all fine.
Wicked.
So you have a playbook advance? Is that what you're...
Well, actually, this last set, the end of a session gives me three. Yeah, I think it's going to be a playbook advance. So that's it for me. Who's next? I think Adam, because he was second, and we're doing reverse downtime order.
Sure.
Yeah, I don't know. Just spiced up.
Okay. So for me, I don't think I rolled any desperate actions today.
No, actually, you didn't this time. Not yeah. This time. It's unusual.
I addressed with both violence and threats, like one of each. I threatened Bajo, and I was violent with the dude.
Totally, yeah. Take two.
So I'll take two for that one. And then expressing beliefs, drives, heritage, or background.
I mean, all those dates, they were beautiful.
Yeah, I mean, I think
that's your number one drive.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, and also you got to remember too, like my heritage is that I'm orphanage trash, and my background is corner boy, right? So the two of those things are all about being born into a bad place and trying to like get up in the criminal hierarchy, right? And to like put myself over people who are above me in that hierarchy.
Yeah, absolutely. Take two for that.
Okay,
yeah.
Cool. So four total.
Did your unstable trauma? I don't think you really did, actually.
No, I was pretty. Because things are going well. Like it's when things go bad that I get unstable.
Yeah.
Cool.
All right. I did have one desperate action, which was working on Bajo. So I took a mark that played with advance. When I just took challenge with violence or threats, I'm going to take it for being straight up threatening to Bajo and saying like, you need to fucking do this.
I totally agree.
So I was going to take one for that. And I don't know about taking another for basically giving the assist with Cyclops. I feel like that's a little indirect. That wasn't like my plan. It later on became what happened, was like training with my guys. Like basically, does that extend into the realm of tactics and things like that?
Not
like,
really. I think you need to...
No.
So if you led them into combat, it
would probably count. But this was more support, right?
So I don't think so.
It's cool. I'm just gonna take one. Express my beliefs, drives, and heritage or background. I'm gonna take one for getting in on Kiel, because I think I've been pretty clear that I am going to make my father-in-law pay for trying to mess with my husband.
Yeah.
And I was really trying to play up the saber and cutting the tentacles of the leviathans at sea to bring out the leviathan hunter heritage from Dragon Basha. So I was gonna grab one for that as well.
Yeah, absolutely.
And my vice is lovers, or pleasure rather, and I don't think that came into play, or it didn't. If it did, it certainly didn't bring up an issue for me, unless.
Your vice?
Yeah, my vice is pleasure. I don't think that.
No, I don't think so.
I didn't indulge it. It didn't go crazy. So
yeah.
Yeah. Well, you're the one who doesn't have trauma, so you can actually ignore your vice.
Well, I can't anymore.
You're a little high.
I'm nearly stressed out at this point.
Yeah, I think I'm pretty blown up on stress too. So
yeah. I'm gonna do some indulgence.
Yes.
Are you good, RC?
Yeah, I'm good.
There's this thing called bound to the demon, when having bound yourself by arcane ritual to a demon, you can do stuff.
Yeah.
I was wondering if this might be an appropriate time to take a veteran advance and buy one of those powers.
So are you done with your clock?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Or no, I'm not. I'm 4 out of 8.
Well, then you're not bound yet.
There you go.
All right, we'll continue working.
Sorry.
Proceed.
You're close, but you're not there yet.
I might have to spend some coin next time and just I'll split my XP so that I don't quite level up this time, so I can just pick it up next time.
Sure. I mean, you can just save the advance too. Whatever you want to do.
Oh, okay.
That's fine.
Wicked.
Nice. The crew. Acquire product, attract customers, or covertly sell your contraband.
I don't think we really did any of that because we're setting up turf to do that later.
Yeah, I don't think we did either.
Yeah, I agree. Improve your product's quality, variety, or prestige? No. Bolster your crew's reputation or develop a new one? Yes, you definitely did that.
Yeah.
I would say two. I'd say one for each.
Cool.
Contend with challenges above your current station. I don't think you did, actually. I think it was all level two stuff this time.
Yeah. That's the problem with getting powerful.
First time ever, yeah. Yeah.
Can't pick on the little guys anymore.
So that puts us at seven, or one away. One, two, three, nice. Four, five, six. That's yeah, puts us at seven ticks, so we're one away from our crew advance.
Cool.
Good work, team.
Yeah.
Good priming, everybody.
It was some good criming. We just told Baja that we're partners.
You are partners. You have both. Oh shit, Sean. Sorry. You need to put a clock on your character. I totally forgot. corrupted by the demon blood for four piece one filled.
Oh, but I didn't take any Leviathan blood. I took.
Yeah, you did.
I did.
Yeah.
Awesome. Because Satara just got in on that business.
Yep, she sure did.
All right. Listen, well, this is the thing. It's only this blood stuff is only a problem if only one of us is doing it. If we're all doing it, it's on brand now.
Yeah, give Bajo a clock as well while you're at it then.
Oh yes, I have. When you spill blood and drink it within a foot of Oscar Skurlock, Satara is involved. That's that's just how it is.
I love it. I love it. I love it.
Yeah.
That would be a super abhorrent to RC, but she doesn't.
Yeah, no, it's I think it's, I don't think it's known to her at all yet.
Yeah.
It's a secret clock.
Yeah, I think that's going to make her freak out when she realizes.
Yeah, I'm sure.
Yeah, you don't say.
All right.
She wakes up one morning and is like, is my skin peeling? Is there scales there?
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, she's going to.
That's cool. The mechanic we haven't seen yet. It happened a long time ago, like years ago in a Blades game where it was also involving corruption and stuff. And I was like, everyone roll dice equal to your corruption clock segments. Mm. And it's like, wait, what? <That's> Let's cool. See who can get the highest number.
Let's see who's the most corrupted.
Yeah.
Nice.
I love it. Man, there were so many clocks today. That was awesome.
Well, it's because the longer the characters exist, the more they have like projects to work on, right?
So, yeah, totally.
Yeah,
cool. Well, another delightful episode. Thank you so much for playing, everybody.
Yeah, thanks, guys. That was super fun.
That was pretty great. If you're watching this, you can follow us all on the Twitters. Our handles are available there. John, if people want to find out more about Blades, where's the best place for them to go and do that?
Yeah, right now the G+ community is probably the best place. It's the most active place to talk about the game and find out more about it. I don't have an actual website for it yet because I'm working on other projects.
Yeah, it turns out there's this game that you're working on that needs to be finished, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. And on DriveThruRPG, you can buy the early access edition of the game and follow along at home and make your own characters and play the game if you want to. So that's a good place to go to.
You can find out what happens when one of us dies and becomes a ghost. That's
ghost playbook.
Yeah, there's all kinds of neat stuff in the quick start. So yeah, you can check that out on DriveThru. Today we played using version 6, just so in case people want to correlate the PDF they have with what they just saw, that's how that works. And we'll play again. It seems like we're playing like once every like 4-ish weeks. So if you want to catch up, you want to watch any of the earlier episodes, they're all available on YouTube. There's a Blades command in the Twitch chat if you want to get more information there, get some links. So you can check that out. I suppose until next time, thanks for coming. And a goodbye from the Six Towers gang. I guess with the blood letters now.
The blood letters now.
That's the like.
Yeah.
All right. See you next time, everybody. Thanks for coming.
Not at all.